So welcome everybody at the Disruption Network Club 15 events. We are really happy to introduce now the conference Dark Heavens, Confronting Hidden Money and Power. We have been already doing a long introduction yesterday, so today we will do a bit shorter. But first I would like to introduce the team that is working with us, and also I'm really happy to say us instead of me, because from this year we are actually two directors of the Disruption Network Club, and here close to me there is Lieke Plucher that is going to direct the community program that we call Activation for the whole year. So yeah, welcome Lieke, and also I would like to thank first of all our great team that made this conference possible. Daniela Silvestrin, Nada Bakker, and Monty Harmony, that are our project managers, and also Jonas Franke and Joe Haveman. Jonas is working in the design that you always see here behind, and Joe is our PR manager. So I would like to do a great applause to them, because of course it's also thanks to them that we have this conference. And then another big thank goes to Transparency International. We have been working with the International Secretariat. And as you know, Transparency International is the global coalition against corruption. And we started cooperation with them for the next 2 years under the title The Art of Exposing Injustice. And I feel really to thank deeply Michael Hornsby, that has been working with me a lot to create this conference, and today we will see him moderating the second panel, and then Max Haywood that will moderate the keynote today, and Mayra Martini that was speaking yesterday. And then our funder, the Upstadt Kulturfonds, the Capital Culture Fund of Berlin, the Riva and David Logan Foundation, the Checkpoint Charlie Foundation, and we are also supported by a grant of the Open Society Initiative for Europe within the Open Society Foundations, and we work in partnership with the Friedrich Ebert Stiftung. Then we have our wonderful partner venues, the Constantkreuzberg Bethanien Supermarkt. We will have Ella Kagel, the founder of Supermarkt, being here moderating the first art talk, and also tomorrow we will do a workshop there, and the State Studio, where we do our community program. And we work also in collaboration with the Alexander von Humboldt Institute for Internet and Society and the Whistleblower Network FAO. And finally, our communication partners are Sinnwerkstatt and Förderfield. So yesterday we had a really long day of a very important discussion and talk. We also show the premiere of the film The Panama Paper. And today we are going on with our program that we want, usually we define it as exploring the inner mechanism of the financial system and the crime, corruption, and wrongdoing hidden by offshore companies. So from one side, today we will analyze the artistic perspective related to this issue. Then we will have a keynote with Frederick Obermeier about the Panama Papers. And finally, we will have a panel about the persecution of journalists and whistleblowers that are working with the discourse of anti-corruption and trying to expose this form of injustice. And now I want to leave the word to Lieke, that will introduce Ella Kagel, and then we can start our program.
Thank you. So yeah, we will start with the artistic talk, which will be introduced and moderated by Ella Kagel, who is a digital strategist and the founder of Supermarkt, which is a great space here in Berlin-Kreuzberg, where we will also have the workshop of RYBN.org tomorrow. Ella specializes in the intersection of society, technology, and economy, and she has been working since the 1990s on producing media art exhibitions, designed spaces for cultural exchange, and also helped to establish digital platforms, networks, and communities. And central to her practice is supporting the bottom-up initiatives that are deeply rooted in particular communities of practice. And she has founded the Supermarkt space in 2010, And this is an independent hub for digital culture and collaborative economy, which is an awesome initiative here close by in Kreuzberg. Mm-hmm. So welcome to Ella.
And welcome to everyone.
And to our webien.org.
Thank you very much, Tatjana and Lieke, for the kind words, and hello, everyone. I'm very happy to introduce the artist collective RYBN to you. And today we have Marika and Kevin representing the rest of the collective. So RYBN was founded in 1999. So this marks your 20-year anniversary, basically. And more than 10 years ago, the collective has already picked up on topics, or I would rather say really looked at this peculiar zone between art, technology, money, and data, and engaged on many long-term investigations to explore this field a little bit better. Today, Marika and Kevin will present The Great Offshore, which is it's a huge body of work, and it's the result of many visits in tax havens worldwide. And it's the result of an in-depth investigation on how tax avoidance schemes actually work. Also, this entire question of representation of the offshore activities in our societies, because we all tend to think that this is something very distant and it's actually not belonging into our world, but we will hear from you that it very much does, and that it actually founds an integral part of the economy. So RYBN will also host the workshop tomorrow at Supermarkt, and this will be a great opportunity for participants to understand how these structures actually manifest into our daily lives. And there will also be a community event. I'm sure that Lieke will present that. It's on April 17th when we will reflect on these on the tour. Okay, but I'll stop here, and I want to give the word to Marika. Warm welcome.
Thank you. So thank you for the invitation. So I'm part of this artistic collective called RYBN, which is also an independent artistic platform for research created so in 1999, as you said. And our artistic projects are based in long-term investigations. To conduct this investigation, we use the extradisciplinary methodology proposed by Brian Holmes. And the extradisciplinary is an artistic intrusion in field reserved for experts, and usually distant from the art field. So following this methodology, we have explored high frequency trading, algorithmic trading, market structure and flash crashes, artificial intelligence, labor division and human computer, neural network, machine learning and digital labor, and cybernetic, cryptography, and Kabbalah. So as you said, I will talk about the Great Offshore Project, which is dedicated to offshore finance and shadow banking. And this project aims to shape a global image of the offshore financial industry and to highlight how it is pictured, how it works, the historical layers, the actual developments, and to understand how it has grown, spread, and how it has become the norm. So how it is pictured, the representation focus is central here in our research. According to Alain Deneau, the modern imaginary of tax haven is built on colonial aesthetics, as the image you can see here, and which is the cover of the guide Chambaud. And the more recent cliché of mailboxes from Cayman Island post offices is also construction. So quoting Alain Deneau, there is a managerial, ideological, and juridical language that has managed to corrupt everything. And we are prisoners of this vocabulary. To this statement, we add what works for semantics and vocabulary can be applied also to semiotics and beyond imaginaries. So economy has colonized our imaginaries. So to be able to define, describe, and criticize the offshore finance with efficiency and accuracy, we need to renew this vocabulary and the image we use to picture it. Indeed, what kind of image can be produced when this industry is secret, opaque, hidden, transnational, reason-based, and obfuscates its traces? So we first tried to represent this paradoxal impossibility of representation itself. And also, therefore, for this investigation, we decided to also to visit the main tax havens. The goal was to see how this industry shapes the local landscapes. So we traveled to Delaware, Switzerland, Liechtenstein, the city of London, Dublin, Jersey, Guernsey, Bahamas, Cayman Island, Malta, Luxembourg, and the Netherlands. And it's an ongoing project. For our fieldwork, we have established a methodology of a paranoid investigation that conducted us to bear attention to any signs and to identify every patterns or links between signs. The first goal was to collect traces of the fiscal alchemy to discover local specificities, common language. Once again, we were confronted to a paradox, being in the vortex of financial offshore territories without having anything to catch from this fluid and hidden offshore flows. So we decided to create a technical tool to help us to see the invisible. And this tool is called Offshore Tour Operator. It's a sailing instrument that can fit with a small bag, like this one. And this is what we will use tomorrow for the workshop. Or it can fit into a suitcase also. And it's a tax haven audio guide in the scale of the city that guide you in the scale of the city and to the hotspot of the offshore finance. It's a very wearable computer governed by psychogeography principle from the situationist. And the prototype is combining GPS plus a small computer, batteries, a compass, and the offshore leaks database from the ICIG website. So as you might know, this database is published online as a result of the work of the International Consortium of Investigative Journalists on the recent leaks, Panama Papers, offshore leaks, Bahamas leaks, Paradise Papers, with almost 800,000 identities, client, proxy, operators of the tax haven worldwide network, including their relationship and their location. So technically, for each address, we have added GPS coordinates. The offshore tour operator geolocalizes the user and indicates the four closest locations from ICIG database. So this is in Jersey. Saint-Hélier. And this is a record you can find online too, from our offshore tour we made in Jersey, in Saint-Hélier exactly. On the left side of the screen, you can see the name of the companies that are indexed in this database, and that we reach when we pass by them. And on the right, it's the name of the Wi-Fi we can catch with the computer. So sometimes you see there is a long list of companies that are just around us. So we record each tour, and we use OpenStreetMap to visualize them. So I will stop now, it's go more. And during our travel, this offshore tour guide drives us into very different buildings related to this shadow industry. So business building, financial skyscraper, wealthy residential neighborhood, but also very common ones like restaurants or shop or private houses or even dead ends or parkings. We even founded the churches in Nassau and also in Amsterdam. So each time we reach a point, we take a photo at least to have the trace of the building, the facade. And these pictures are all have all been taken during the Jersey offshore tour you just have seen before on the map. So also the offshore leaks database is public, as I said, and this industry is based on secrecy. So of course, some of the addresses pointed by the journalists are not valid anymore. And we were put in a strange situation of following ghosts, tracking a former activity that was secret and that has moved or disappeared. So for example, here, by playing with the contrast of the picture, you can visualize that there were like the UBS Swiss Bank logo on this building. It was in Jersey, in Saint-Hélier. So we also propose to other people to experiment the device. And this picture has been taken during the cross-border workshop in, that we did in Basel. The experience increases your attention. It transforms everyone into a paranoid. And focusing on the details that you would not have noticed in a formal, normal situation. And it gives you a second layer of interpretation of the streets. You also get a suspicious behavior as you walk slowly, randomly, and you are coming and going back, taking notes, photo, because the GPS guide indicates you a direction to take with the GPS. So sometimes it's there is a bit of delay. So as you are close, you are searching a bit your path. And so sometimes people manage to get inside the buildings and want to interact with the names and let message in the mailing box, mailbox. So as the addresses are obsolete and complete or partial, we add also addresses on the map that point to specific locations, such as the one in Basel, targeting the actor of the tax evasion through the art market, including transportation, storage in Freeport. And to increase the map, we will work with a specialist, expert. In May, we will meet Belgian initiatives called the Lobby Tour with, from the Corporate Europe Observatory and Désorceler la Finance. And we are also in discussion with a criminologist from the Netherlands National Prosecution Service. So to conclude on this offshore tour, with this this tool, we could experience and visit the physical manifestation of the unveiled actor of these shadow networks. But offshore tour reflects also the tip of the iceberg and enlightens the quick obsolescence of information. Moreover, it's at a local scale, it's this insignificant facade and common location around us materialize this ubiquitous and multi-shaped flow of the global liquid capital. So this software is also in open source. And so now the second part of the project, the Great Offshore, is called AlgOffshore. And with AlgOffshore, we try to describe the mechanisms and the processes of the offshore finance, so how it works. So starting from scratch, we try to first understand the global dynamic of this industry. And according to Gabriel Zucman, it's not as complex as it is claimed everywhere. We try to summarize in these global dynamics that sustains the world system into flowcharts. So we try to summarize it like that, as a subtle and simple imbrication between transparent, semi-transparent and opaque economics, legislation and actors. So we express it in a three-dimensional scheme, but we can also express it in a four-dimensional or five or six dimension, etc. But the logic behind stay always the same. Transparent and opaque economics are always linked to each other. So AlgOffshore series try to detail all these relations. They are flowcharts of software. And this first one, AlgOffshore, is a tax evasion scheme generator. It's a system that scans all tax imposition level and all bilateral agreements between countries to shape and define the best routes for tax optimization schemes. This flowchart describes all steps between the main process and all the sub processes. So I propose to go closer and discover it step by step. So this first step is the record of the user parameters, such as the country of residency, the type of business, the complexity of the structure defined by the number of nodes. And the user can customize this, the network shape of with these parameters. Then, on step two, the software analyzes the information he got from internet and specifically OECD database to store the up-to-date bilateral tax agreement between the country, the one who are active. On step three, then the software generates an optimal route or a tax optimization scheme that attempts to reach a tax efficiency. On step four, the software will optimize and solidify the scheme. So it changes and moves ownership of nodes to optimize the route and to optimize the benefits. It's using transfer pricing to optimize the benefits location. On step five, the software monitors and surveys the structure by analyzing internet with big data features and by initiating a clause de fuite, or FLI clause, or CUBA clause, with if any issue is detected, or on the social networks, or in the news. Then we jump to the final step, which is the one where the software generates a step-by-step instruction set in order to facilitate the setup. This generative program is an ongoing process too, so all your input are very welcome. We need your expertise to evaluate the efficiency of the system, to improve it regarding your knowledge on tax evasion. So like for the offshore tour, we work with activists and specialists to continue to develop it. That's why we applied also this feedback methodology last year on the second AlgOffshore, which is dedicated to the tax optimization through art and the art market. When we were invited by HEC, House der Elektronische Kunst, to exhibit the work at Liszt Art Fair during Art Basel, we collected all the feedback from the very involved operator of this industry that were visiting our exhibition. We increased it on site during the week of the exhibition. So the software is a system that generates tax optimization schemes using art as a speculative vehicle. And the algorithm takes advantage of every possible offshoring strategy to compute a personalized solution for any interested collectors. So again, the step one is the personalization of the scheme by collecting data on the sale, such as the buyer, the seller, intermediary, the artwork. Then the step two, the software engage a trade procedure through anonymization, tax avoidance, speculation, or laundering. So to zoom in the anonymization process, it is done through the use of private sale, trust, and freeport in a triple screen strategy, which are there. So we can maybe go inside the detail later. So then the tax avoidance permits flat fees to also, by the use of a resale certificate that we can obtain, it processes to a like kind exchange in the US, for example, and to a lending or a gift to a museum. So then tax avoidance, no, we did it. The speculation, the third one, so we can zoom in, is using strategy like creating intermediaries, price manipulation, like shield bidding. It creates a certificate of authenticity, and it's possible to exhibit the artwork to escape and to speculate on the artwork. Then the last one is the laundering, which is, as you know, converting illegal assets into legitimate ones through private and anonymous art sales. So this sub-process have been added during the art fair, but because we followed the advice of one collector who went to visit us at the exhibition. It was not in the first version of this scheme, it was not included, and we included through the advice of a visitor. Voilà, and the last AlgOffshore is about the process of anonymization, and it is called anonymization swarm. And the software is a system that anonymizes the identity of a given user in order to optimize the tax assets through the use of a network of proxies that is called Swarm. The user can customize, as before, the optimization scheme with personal parameters. So it records and encrypts the user parameters. Then it, the software opens a bank account in a secure offshore location. It creates a shell company. It transfers the ownership of the account to the shell company. Then it transfers the ownership of the shell company to a trust. And we can repeat it many times. And then it organizes a swarm of shell companies and distributes the asset of the user in these multiple shell entities. At least it creates a foundation that will manage in fine the bank account. En fait, je suis vachement courte. J'ai fini. So as a conclusion, I would I would say the project focuses on this idea that financial offshore is central, structural, systemic, and it has become the norm. It's the norm of what we can call a liquid capital and a flexible legislation and adaptive governance that goes together. The representation topic is central because it is used usually to legitimate by this industry to legitimate the offshore finance and to disarm the critic. So we need to renew it continuously. And the offshore tour operator aims to create some mental images through the experience, through the body, relocating the offshore finance in a local environment to try to reactivate this critic. And at least the AlgOffshore that we plan to patent aims to enlighten the principle more than to describe the mechanism and to highlight also the simplicity of its goals behind the apparent illusory complexity of the system. So that's all.
Thank you very much, Marika, for this amazing presentation. I have a brief question. Since we started later, do we still have time to ask the audience to contribute? Okay, that's fine. I have one question to you, because what I understand from your work, what's really important for you is to help visualizing what's going on. And also, when I read through the website, I came across this notion of the crisis of representation. And you also mentioned that in the end of your talk. So all these images of beaches and palm trees and the mailboxes is indeed the standard visual vocabulary that we get to see. So to what extent is it important for your work to sort of replace that, and in order to not only create a mental imagery landscape, but to create actual images of how this shadow industry looks? Maybe Kevin, you can talk a little bit about that.
For this, we use a very simple metaphor that we borrow to Alain Deneau. He talked about the colonization of language. And it's true, like the if we think through, the words we use are usually forged and shaped in a way that are they don't give us the possibility to express in very clear terms. And if we want to address economics or offshore as a modality of governance and try to deconstruct it and to understand it, we need to reforge words. And the same applies to image. So we need really like to it's a work. I think it's also a collective work. That's why we open this process as a workshop. And that's why also we do it in open source and all this kind of open and modality, because it's not like a work we can do alone, but it's like a collective work to reshape these vocabularies and to recreate these images, I guess.
Want to add something, Marika?
Yeah, just the picture we showed before about the Git Chambo and the one about the mailboxes. They are what built our imaginary of the offshore banking. And when I said that it's a construction for the second one, the mailboxes, it's because, in fact, it's more precise than the first one, which is like a beautiful sand, yes, with palmier, etc. But we went there, and in fact, the post office system is like that. It's not reserved for the companies. Everybody, nobody has a mailbox behind his house. It's everybody go to take his mails at the post office. So it's just a little trick from this picture when it's used as an image of tax haven. Hmm.
So you have been working on this project since years, and it seems to be far from being complete. Do you have any next steps in mind, something that you feel should follow and build on that, what is already there? Or is it now just about expanding what you already have?
No, there is also an evolution in the process of work, because we start 2 years ago. We worked on an exhibition in Espace Multimédia Grantner at the end of 17. And for that, we really worked on this methodology to capture signs everywhere. And document a lot, but after this exhibition, we continue. So we went in Malta, in Luxembourg, and in the Netherlands. And there was more. It was our work was more focused on for Malta on and Luxembourg to the recent law that have been voted that. For the Luxembourg focus the Luxembourg to the economy of the extraction and the exploitation of space, and by combining the space extraction economy or, the possibility of tax evasion and adaptive governance they propose, because this is a small country, they don't have it's not a space agency in itself. So what they propose, it's a new kind of service, which is like to join into this market with this possibility of financial offshore, and to adapt the law to the market. So. With, for example, with this travel and research on the Luxembourg activities, we went more into the focusing into the way the governance is changing, and more and more privatize.
Thank you. Okay, let's take a couple of minutes to see whether we have questions, please. There's a question here.
Thank you very much. My name is Inke Arndt. I have a question about the second project you presented. The first one is pretty clear to me. It's this offshore tour operator. But maybe you could explain a little bit what exactly is the focus of the second project, Algo Offshore. You presented these flowcharts. And I'm not so sure what your plan is with this, because at the end you also mentioned you want to patent this. So it, you know, the next step would be a booth at Art Basel, right? And then kind of offer your services. It's a very evil thought, right? Maybe you can expand a little bit on that, what your plans are to develop this further.
Yeah, okay. It's, actually, it's pretty simple. It started, there was a quote in a book from Xavier Harel called La Grande Évasion. So it's a French book about offshore tax haven and offshore industry. And at a moment, he mentioned in this book the fact that all the big audit companies, like the Big Four, KPMG, PwC, etc., etc., they were patenting methods of tax avoidance, which were pretty like a contradictory move, in a way. Like it, at the moment, it's really like a kind of paradoxical object. So we decided also to research a little bit on that. So we began to download all the kind of patents we can find. And then we were also thinking, okay, let's, because there was this LuxLeaks file, which are pretty straightforward in terms of methodology, we began to think also like, can we reduce these very specific examples into a kind of more general method? And if we can do that, what happens if we patent it? I mean, it creates obfuscation and it creates like a kind of impossibility also to reuse this kind of. So it's, that's why we need to work with lawyers and tax lawyers. Because you can find also some which are pretty involved on the other side. They are not all evil, I guess. I hope so. And so the move is just as simple as that. So it's really like a kind of, it's an attempt, you know, if I'm clear.
There is one more question here and one over there.
Yes, hi. Thank you very, very much for this presentation, which I found fascinating. And as an artistic researcher myself, I think the project is, well, funny also in many ways. I see a lot of humor in it. So my question is, and I'm not sure whether or not you're already doing this, and if so, sorry. But I was thinking, instead of just representing and automating the evasion mechanism, and maybe this pertains to both projects, what would happen, or have you considered pushing the envelope to maybe think steps or many steps ahead of the current evasion mechanisms, maybe visualizing, devising new creative artistic ways of evasion, sort of imagining the future of evasion, maybe even a speculative evasion of the super rich of tomorrow, super rich evasions on Mars, etc. That kind of approach. I know it's a bit playing devil's advocate or helping envision, but it also might present new solutions of how to deal with these mechanisms, foresee where they would go, etc. That's my question.
I just yes, of course. To react on one point is, it's not only about super rich, but mainly about multinational. So that's one point. Et après, j'ai perdu le fil.
No, just yeah, we, sorry for the sound engineer. Yes, to react. Actually. What we were explaining just before about this Luxembourg space mining law, it's actually the actual research, so that's why we don't really present it right now, because it's in the process of investigating. Actually, we began to have tons of interviews with the Luxembourg Space Agency, also the Hague Space Governance Working Group, which are shaping the what we call building blocks. And it's true, like the first thing you think when you begin to work with this material is like, what will be the future of offshore with the space as a playground? And it's the very first thing you think. But I guess our interest is really into governance. So we also try to come back. So actually, like I think science fiction is a very good tool, especially anticipation, or like Philip K. Dick essays, for example, when it describes the present. So the future is a good tool also to establish a good critique of the present. So in this way, it's maybe something we are trying to do right now with this next project, which is called the Space Offshore, and it will be presented next month in Espace Multimédia Grantenaire in Belfort.
So we have time for one last question. Please, over here.
Thank you. My name is Juanita Olaya. I have two questions. One regarding the first project. I don't know if it's part of your aim, but have you had any feedback of the participants on your tours? And has that in any way changed or shaped any future ideas about what to do next, or shaped them, the participants themselves? And the second question, I came in a bit late, so if you talked about that and I'm asking for something you already said, forget it. But I would be curious to know, how did you start this project? What brought you to this idea to work on this?
Yes, in fact, I maybe not mentioned it, but the offshore tour operator is a prototype. So we start to build one version while we were traveling ourselves in tax havens. But of course, there is a lot of feedback. I try to summarize them in my presentation. So the description of the experience is one thing, and this is a very important feedback for us. And during the workshop we will do tomorrow, it's also a part of the workshop itself. And at the same time, regarding the technique aspect, of course, we improve and we change the software with the feedback, with the discussion with the people and the users, I mean. And maybe je cherche un exemple.
I'm sorry. Okay. So just to quickly pick up on that, the question was if there was any sort of feedback that resulted already in actions of social change. If I get that right. That was the question. And maybe, Kevin, you can already combine that with answering what brought you to start all of that.
Yeah, maybe I can start with the second question, and maybe let's see if it allows us to go to the first question, like in this kind of. For the second question, actually, it's pretty simple. It's been years we are working on this kind of visualization of the dynamic of the market, and slowly it brought us to create what we call algorithms of trading algorithms that we use as a hard vehicle on the market, and being like a total cybernetic idea. And in this cybernetic, you have like what we call algorithmic governmentality, which is like maybe one of the main theory about like the transformation of society upon technology. But you have the same and the mirror theory in economics, which is called the governance by numbers, which was coined by Alain Supiot, professor in Collège de France in Paris. And I think like this notion of governance brought us directly to the tax haven and the offshore world, because actually this is, in our opinion, a model of governance. Offshore is not anymore a technique or a marginal, it's a technique of governance. So that's why we came to that. And I think it's something which was also said by Nicolas Jackson yesterday, and it's also something which is begin to be accepted by a lot of different researchers. There was a lot of articles like in December about it. We discussed a lot also with Alain Deneau about this. So I think like the whole idea of the project itself is to try to reincorporate the offshore into something which is like more mainstream, into this mainstream flow. And about the feedback, it remains like a, you know, silly art project, you know, with their very small scale dimensions. So it's not here to like let's say to transform the world. But indeed, it creates like in terms of micropolitics. If we follow the micropolitics lead, and it's something we are also very much involved into it. Yes, it creates at some local scale in local groups discussion and trying also to. It's like a discussion enabler. It's a moment where we talk about politics. So, and if we accept politics as a kind of a group discussion. So I guess the only feedback, social feedback, is this, this kind of micro group of discussion of politics.
Marika and Kevin, thank you so much for the talk and for answering those questions. I'm looking forward to the workshop tomorrow, and thanks everyone.
Thank you very much to both of you and Ella. I just wanted to say that we are now doing a 15 minutes break and to come punctual back, because then we will have the keynote with Frederick Obermeier. So see you soon.